In the last talk, I discussed the themes that I cover in my novel Portofino, the book Dancing Alone, and the book Letters to Father Aristotle. And I want to begin this talk by finishing off just the story of my personal journey into Orthodoxy, and then going to the subject, which it dovetails very well, which is the church. Is it a feeling or a historical fact? The title of this lecture. After I had spent a number of years reading church history and some of the anti-Nicene fathers, during that period of time, I began as a Protestant to look at what I believed to be the historical church. And coming from a Protestant background, to me, the historical church, of course, was the Western historical church, which is Roman Catholicism. And for quite some time, I attended various Roman Catholic churches, off and on, while at the same time going to an Episcopal church with my family on a steady basis. A number of my friends in those years and before had become Roman Catholics for much the same reason that I myself was on the way out of Protestantism, a desire for the historical church, a desire for apostolic inheritance, a desire for worship that was liturgical and that was not man-made. I had family friends such as Malcolm Muggeridge, the British writer who was a friend of my father's, who became a Roman Catholic after he had become a Christian. I have a family friend in the area I live in, north of Boston, Thomas Howard, who came from a famous evangelical missionary family, whose sister, his sister is Elizabeth Elliot, and Tom became a Roman Catholic. And I was doing a lot of reading from Western Church Fathers as well as the Eastern Church. And so I started going to some Roman Catholic churches. In brief, as I mention in my book, Dancing Alone, and develop further in Letters to Father Aristotle, why I did not become a Roman Catholic Christian, what stopped me was not that I compared Catholicism and Orthodoxy. I decided that I could not become a Roman Catholic before I really knew there was an Orthodox Church in the sense that I had an alternative. It was at a stage of my life where I had decided unequivocally, based on very good evidence and as well as observation, that whatever historic Christianity was, it certainly was not the American modern sectarian Protestant experience. But the choice that seemed to lie before me was either to go into the Roman Catholic Church or to simply be a kind of personal individual Christian. You know the type, the beach is my church. I can pray anywhere. You know, it's just me and my Lord Jesus, and that's good enough. You know, what do I need a church for? And I even wrote that nonsense at one point, I'm ashamed to say, in a book on Christianity and the arts where I was saying, you know, you can read your Bible on the beach. I think I even used that example. So you see, not only Californians write crazy things. You can live in Massachusetts and think the beach is a spiritual place too, you know. Although only for 3 months of the year, because it's a little chillier. But anyway, I was of that mind. So I had this kind of grandiose idea that I could, you know, maybe one thing was just to despair and say, there is no historical church left. It's run into the sands. This must be the end times. I'll just wait for spaceship Jesus to come back and get me. And in the meantime, I'll go to the beach and read my Bible and conduct Bible studies for my wife and children, or perhaps I'll become a Roman Catholic. Well, those are not good alternatives, and I'm very fortunate I discovered Orthodoxy. So today, I'll begin by just simply saying that the reason I became Orthodox rather than Catholic, or rather decided not to become Roman Catholic, and then did not know where to go until I stumbled fortuitously into the Orthodox Church, comes down to two things. One, very personal and related to the time we are in now. Frankly, I didn't want to jump from the frying pan into the fire. And if what I was trying to leave and what I was rebelling against was touchy-feely, make-it-up-as-you-go-along Christianity, non-liturgical, extemporaneous chaos, no accountability, fragmented Christianity, then to get into the modern American Roman Catholic situation was simply to just jump from one chaotic place into another. You have to understand, a lot of people get their information about Roman Catholicism from old movies or from some idea of the Vatican and the papacy. And what you don't understand, unless you've experienced it on a very ordinary basis of going down the street to your local Roman Catholic church or parochial school, is that Catholicism is as fragmented today when it comes to worship and accountability as Protestantism is. It's fully sectarian itself. You've got left-wing Marxist Marinole nuns who on the far left. You have fist-in-your-face feminists like Mary Daly talking about patriarchal tyranny. You've got the old post-pre-Vatican II Tridentine Latin Mass Roman Catholics hanging on to a past liturgical form. You have the local parochial school where children are serving the Eucharist, as I saw just recently going to an event at our local Roman Catholic community. Kids hanging out to the Eucharist, one of them drops one of it, another kid steps on it, somebody just sweeps it up. According to the book, none of this is supposed to happen. But as every traditional American Roman Catholic knows, who has been around, modern American Catholicism is in as much chaos as Protestantism is. And so aside from theory, who is the church, practically, if you're looking for something solid and liturgical and dignified and Christian, if you want to put it that way, and you are tired of the plurality of diversity, as if you can just choose this, choose that, choose the other, the last place you'd go is the modern American Roman Catholic Church. Now, that's not a comment on Roman Catholicism as a historical phenomenon. In that area, I had another problem, as I talk about in both Dancing Alone and Letters to Father Aristotle. And that is that, in my opinion, when I read church history, I see a lot of things, but one thing I do not see is the modern papacy. There is no infallible pope in the historical church until it evolved between the 6th and the 9th centuries. The papacy's infallible powers are rooted back into its political pretensions, as the popes in the 6th century cut deals with people like Pepin and then later Charlemagne and became papal states and commanded armies and allegiances and made emperors and all the rest of this, trying to shore up the papal states. And gradually you have this evolution into this absolute papacy. When I read church history, not as an Orthodox, but as a Protestant, what I found was a collegial tradition of authority. Independent bishops bound together, not by the iron will of a man in Rome, but by a shared common loyalty to a tradition, and the Holy Spirit led this body, not the vicar of Christ. The bishop was not Christ on earth or his representative. He was a sinful human being who never spoke infallibly. And his authority was derived from the whole church, but alone he was just a man. And so no bishop could pronounce on something without coming together in a council of all the bishops in his region, area, or the world, the great ecumenical councils, the first seven, or sending a representative, because alone the bishop, just like a priest, just like anyone else, is simply a human, infallible man. It is only within the whole body that that person has certain authority. And we see that even with the apostles. The same Peter that says it seems good to us, notice he didn't say me, it seems good to us and the Holy Spirit, is the same Peter who denies Christ three times only a few months earlier. One does not trust Peter, but one trusts the church, because the Holy Spirit guides that body. And so on an intellectual, historical level, quite frankly, not because of my Protestant background, believe me, I had long since left those shores. But the papacy itself is really an intolerable concept from the point of view of church history. It really is very, very difficult to defend, as opposed to the way the Eastern Church has always seen things, and the Western Church too, by the way, until very recently. And that was that you have this collegial authority shared between all the bishops, and that the reason the Bishop of Rome has special authority is the same reason the Bishop of Antioch, Constantinople, Jerusalem, and certain other sees that are now no more had authority, and that is they represent the most ancient teaching of the church in one place with unbroken continuity, and one reveres them the way one reveres one's great-grandfather or grandmother, because they have that wisdom of that family. They have been there, they have seen, they have learned something. But it had nothing to do with the Bishop of Constantinople speaking ex cathedra as the vicar of Christ or anything else. Rome was given special place of precedence because of its centrality, obviously being the center of the empire into which Christianity came until Constantinople was founded. But the papacy as a modern phenomena, where you have an infallible pope, was simply unknown in the historic church. And the best Roman Catholic historians all know this to be the case. And they simply, when you get past high school level Roman Catholic propaganda and you read serious theologians, you will find that they have to accept the papacy completely on faith. It has nothing to do with history. It's simply an interpretation of certain Bible verses as being upon this rock and so forth. In other words, it's got nothing to do with historic precedents because there really isn't any. In fact, we find Gregory the Great writing against people declaring themselves ecumenical representatives. And we find other Roman Catholics even up to the time of the 19th century when infallibility was declared a dogma. Even there, you had Roman Catholic bishops protesting vigorously and saying this can't be. So you don't find a united front. Now, this talk isn't about Roman Catholicism, but it's worth mentioning because those of us from a Western background, of which most of us here are, naturally think of Catholicism when we think of the historic church. So I soon despaired of that avenue. If I want to go into a church where some nun's playing a guitar and hanging out pink balloons on Earth Day, I can stay right in the Episcopal Church and do that too. And if I want to be part of an infallible dictatorship, then I can go live in Cuba or wherever it might be and find one. But if I'm looking for the historic church, then coming from a Protestant background with an open heart, I began to wonder if it hadn't just petered out into the sands of time. And then a friend of mine who lives in Northern California, and Ben Lohman, by the name of Jim Bouffier, who now is the publisher of The Christian Activist, the newspaper I edit, Jim and I, who had been friends for 20 years at that point, and now it's longer, had been trading books and ideas because he was on a very similar spiritual journey. He's a movie producer and I'm a director, and we've been thrown together on a lot of projects, made a lot of things. He also comes from a Protestant evangelical background, and he and I had been tracking together. Well, Jim calls me up one day. I'm living in Massachusetts, north of Boston, and he's living in Ben Lomond in Northern California, and he says, I found what we've been looking for. And I said, well, what? You know, an executive producer with an open checkbook? What are you talking about? He says, no, I mean spiritually. I found the church we've been reading about. I found the church of Eusebius and Ignatius. Because you see, he had gone to a local Roman Catholic church for a while too and left in absolute despair because of the liturgical state of chaos that he found and the just simple lack of beauty. You know, the ugliest thing in the world are the modern Roman Catholic liturgies. And I'm not saying that. Ask any traditional Roman Catholic. They're in tears over the liturgical chaos in their community. Whole newspapers, by the way, by traditionalists, are circulated in Roman Catholic churches denouncing, in far harsher terms than I'd ever dare use, their liturgical state of affairs. So he had despaired of that, and for 3 or 4 years hadn't gone to church anywhere, wouldn't darken the door of a church. And he said, well, I found what we've been reading about. I found what we are looking for. Well, I was a little skeptical. I said, you found the historic church in California? I have wine in my cellar older than their whole state. What are you talking about? You know, the first church of Jane Fonda or something. So my feeling was one of utmost skepticism, that wherever you look, it wouldn't be California. So I was picturing, you know, one of these crazy things like these insane medieval festivals they have in towns, you know, where everybody dresses up in bad costumes and jousts on cart horses and this kind of thing. Some sort of recreation. You know, some guy had gotten hold of a book, a Protestant pastor somewhere, and read enough so that he put it together and had recreated a historical church. But Jim is a very astute and sincere person. So in the end, I gave in and flew all the way out to California to go to church. And that's mighty expensive church attendance, I'll tell you. And I went up to the community of St. Peter, St. Paul, which is an Antiochian church in Ben Lomond with Father John Weldon Hardenbrook, who coincidentally himself is a convert. I didn't really know that at the time. He used to be the second in command up the road in San Bernardino at Campus Crusade. And he, along with the whole top brass of Campus Crusade, with the exception of Bill Bright himself, about 15 years before, had begun a journey toward the historic church, and now all these guys who used to lead Campus Crusade, for instance, Jack Sparks, who's a priest now, who is the man who basically, quote, invented the Jesus movement and was on the cover of Life magazine baptizing people in swimming pools in Berkeley. they were all wandering around in long robes and stringy beards. And so I began to, I sort of thought, well, I don't know about this at all, you know. But when I got up there, I had an amazing experience that was totally unlooked for, and I would call this what you might term, and I don't mean to be frivolous, but it was sort of a Jurassic Park experience. Why? Well, if you know the theme of that movie, there's this scientist who's been studying dinosaur bones, dusty fossils. And not in his wildest dreams is he ever expecting to ever get closer to a dinosaur than a fossil. And all of a sudden he comes to this place called Jurassic Park, and a real dinosaur lopes by, breathing, fresh in blood, as authentic as any dinosaur has ever been. And of course, to use the term, his mind is absolutely blown, and the whole story functions around these real-life dinosaurs. Well, I had been out there wandering around in the Protestant liturgical desert for my whole life, trying to make the best of a bad situation, wondering why it always seemed to fall so far short, why worship always seemed man-made, why did it depend on the cleverness of preachers who, when you got to know them, they were worse schmucks than you were. Why was it always so disappointing? Why, when you got this package home and unwrapped it, did it never look good anymore? It always disappointed. There was less there than meets the eye every time you went back. And as I say quite often, and I don't mean this unkindly, but truly, you know, I'm amazed by evangelicals who come up to me and say, how can you venerate saints? And I say, yes, indeed, we do venerate saints. The difference between Orthodoxy and Protestantism is we venerate saints. And in Protestantism, I spent my life venerating celebrities. But don't tell me that it wasn't a personality cult. The only difference was the saints are people who lived a whole godly life, finished the course, are an example to the church, and are in heaven praying for the rest of us. The celebrities I've been venerating have run off and blotted their copybook, as the English used to say, ruined their record. It's a broken reed. And that goes for anybody, by the way, me included, first of all. I would hope no one would ever look at me as an example of orthodoxy, because I have plenty of time to undo any good I might do. But we do venerate the saints, because they have gone on. So for me, this Jurassic Park experience occurred because I had been despairing of finding this historical church. And then all of a sudden, like dinosaurs rising out of a marsh, like ghosts coming out of the marble floor of an old church, here was the Liturgy of St. John Chrysostom, and it wasn't the California version, it wasn't the modern version, it wasn't the guitar strumming version, it wasn't the improved, read, ruined version. You know, the American idea of marketing, you take two perfectly decent products, combine them into one horrible one. Coffee, choca, mocha, Viennese, you know, whipped, something. Well, I'll tell you one thing, nobody in Vienna is drinking this garbage. Unless it's Vienna, Wisconsin or something, you know. So I kept waiting for the other shoe to drop. You know, okay, here is the liturgy as I have read and prayed and hoped for. This is the Church of Euguira's pilgrimage to the Holy Land of the 3rd century, undefiled, complete, in one piece. Okay, when does the other shoe drop? You know, when is the guitar solo? When does the weird sermon get preached? And all of a sudden you've got a guy up there denying the virgin birth and making it up as he goes along. When does the other shoe drop? And the other shoe didn't drop. So I stayed up there for a couple of weeks and had a lot of discussions with people. But really, someone says, well, when did you become Orthodox? I became Orthodox for myself in this sense of belief. In the first 10 seconds of the Liturgy of St. John Chrysostom, I knew I was home. And I had no inner turmoil about, oh, there's this and there's that and the other. I'll put it another way. For me, it was this or nothing. It was the last stop on the train. After that, the abyss. Because this was the historic church in total, in whole. And it was not being messed around with. It had not been corrupted by this corrupt society. Then my question was, well, where do I go to church? I live in Massachusetts. And I told my wife, And I said to her, you know, we may have to move to California to go to church. Because I don't know if there are any Orthodox churches where I live. And the priests up in Ben Elman said, oh yeah, there are a lot of Orthodox churches where you live. Your part of the country happens to have more Greek Orthodox than Antiochian, but Orthodox is Orthodox, and you'll find them doing the same thing. And I said, come on, they're not going to be doing the same thing. You can't even go down the street to another Protestant church in the same denomination and they're doing the same thing. Only McDonald's does the same thing. They do it consistently, they do it badly, but it is the same. So whatever else, don't tell me that I can go to any Orthodox church somewhere else and they're going to be doing this. It'll be the East Coast version, it'll be the Harvard Divinity School version, it'll be the feminist, politically correct version, it'll be the something version. But don't tell me that I can just go to an Orthodox church. And they said, you can go to any Orthodox church in North America. It may be two little old ladies on their last legs. It may be full of vibrant people, but the liturgy will be the liturgy will be the liturgy. The sacraments will be served. You will not hear weird and wonderful and colorful doctrines being preached from the pulpit. The church is the church is the church. There will be better communities and worse. There will be growing communities. There will be dying communities. There will be corrupt priests and bishops and great priests and bishops. But your experience of worship in the Orthodox Church will be Orthodox. You can count on it. And I said to myself, they are lying. Because you cannot count on anything. Remember, I come from a Protestant background. I tried going to the Episcopal Church for a few years, and I'm not being facetious. This is literal. In our community, if I went left up to Newbury, I could go to a traditional Episcopal church that was sort of liturgical. I could go to a completely dead Episcopal church where at the last Easter sermon I heard there, the priest stood up and he said, we don't know what happened on resurrection morning, so let me greet you this way. Today's greeting at the door is not Christ is risen, but blessed are the perplexed. And he was being serious. Then I could go down to Boston and I could listen to Bishop Barbara, who is a... No. That is her name. Bishop Barbara of Boston, who is an avowed Marxist lesbian, who I could go on any Saturday afternoon and she or some of her priestesses would be blessing lesbian and homosexual marriages. And choose it anywhere you want. It's like throwing a dart. This is all, quote, Episcopalian. The same is true in every other Protestant manifestation. You could go to a Pentecostal church where you had a raving lunatic of an egomaniacal pastor inventing new stuff and getting his people into new craziness, this kind of organized chaos. You could go down the street to a truly godly Bible-believing pastor who loved the Lord Jesus Christ and was more humble than the most humble monk on Mount Athos and who was leading his people toward Christ. And all points in between. But what you couldn't say is pick any Assemblies of God church, pick any Lutheran, pick anything, and just sort of send someone out randomly into the field to choose. In fact, I remember my father telling Billy Graham that. For years, he said, Billy, there's one thing you do that drives me nuts. What's that? At the end of your crusades, you tell people to go to the church of your choice next Sunday. How can you send them like sheep to the slaughter? You know perfectly well that it's Russian roulette. And if they can get into one kind of church, they're going to lose their faith in three sermons. They go to another, they'll grow spiritually. They go to another, and the theology's so bad, who knows where you're going to wind up and what you'll believe. You cannot simply just send them out. You have to give them more theological instruction. And they would have a debate, and Billy would say, well, you know, my job as an evangelist is just to get them starting, and I have to trust God to lead them, and there's only so much I can do. And there's a lot of sense to that. But one thing even Billy Graham didn't believe is that without God's direct intervention on behalf of the newly saved Christian, quote unquote, that they were going to be able to walk into any church and have it be a church. Because we all know that it's all over the place. Well, I was dubious. I went back to Massachusetts, Newburyport, Mass, and looked in the yellow pages because they said it would be Greek under Greek, and it was olive oil, feta cheese, airlines, import-export, real estate, and then there was Greek Orthodox Church. And so not knowing anything about Greek Orthodox churches, and it said Greek this, and it was right next to the Hellenic that, and this, and this, and this, I call up, and very slowly, in words of one sentence, as if addressing a very unintelligent young child, I say, hello, do you speak English? And the priest there, whose name is Father Chris, who's now my priest in Newburyport, thinking that he had a very foreign, perhaps unintelligent, person on the other end of the phone, says very, very slowly back to me, very kindly, being compassionate, as if I was hard of hearing, and very loud, yes, do you? And we could have gone on like this for quite some time, bellowing monosyllabic words at each other. But Father Chris was a captain in the Strategic Air Command for 10 years before he became an Orthodox priest, so he does speak English. And he and I soon struck up a conversation. And what transpired was, is I called him, and I said, I am interested in becoming Orthodox. You know, can I come to your liturgy? I didn't know this is the East Coast version. He said, oh, of course, we welcome visitors, Orthros, 9 o'clock, liturgy 10, see you next Sunday. So I rolled into church off the street. I went without my wife and my children because I had been dragging them on my spiritual journey for 20 years, and so I wasn't about to do this again. Dad's gone off to yet another place to check it out. So I went over there alone, and it was like a miracle. Here I am, 3,500 miles away. This is a Greek Orthodox church. It's not a bunch of ex-convert, whatever, who, you know, are doing this and trying to tell me or influence me. It's really just throwing a dart at the board, you know, the nearest Orthodox community to my house. And all of a sudden, here is this same precious liturgy. Here is a priest who is reading the passage for the day. He's preaching on the same topic that every other priest in Orthodoxy will preach on that Sunday. Here is an orderly community coming up to the liturgy with no wild and woolly manifestations, no shoot from the hip. Nobody is doing something crazy. And this is all, you know, within 30 miles of Harvard Divinity School, too, on the East Coast, where nothing has been left pristine. Remember, this is the hotbed of Unitarianism. This is where no one believes anything. And here is a Greek community, a small Greek immigrant community, basically, and they are carrying the torch of the historic church. Ugaira could step through a time machine from the 3rd century and pray the prayers of the people and know where she was. Because come hell or high water, the church has not thrown its inheritance away. And so I began to go to other Orthodox churches in our area thinking, well, that was a fluke. I've been lucky twice, and I'll go down and check out this Antiochian church down in Cambridge. Because I said to my priest, well, I want to go to another Antiochian church and see. Because I was sure this couldn't be right. I was sure that Orthodox couldn't be Orthodox. And that wouldn't have stopped me, yeah, like a drowning man from jumping on the life raft. But I wanted to really see. So I just randomly started going into Orthodox churches. The liturgy was the liturgy. The prayers of the people were the prayers of the people. Matins and Orthros were Matins and Orthros. The theology was the theology of the church. I met nice priests. I met less nice priests. I went into some churches where I was welcomed. I went into others where you'd think that I was a leper. But I'll tell you what I didn't find. I didn't find make it up as you go along, trivialize chaos. I did not find heresy. I did not find bad things happening in front of the altar. And it was like this, and this is the way I would tell you, and I write about this in letters to Father Aristotle. What I found was is that when you get up on the soleia, which is the soleia, and you look at what happens there and behind the royal doors and the iconostasis and the altar, it is clean. The chalice and the altar have not been defiled. There is no guarantee that everything is not a mess out here, in the same way that just because my wife and I have indeed have a sacramental union in heaven, and what God has joined together, let no man part asunder. But that doesn't mean I treat my wife very well all the time. That doesn't mean I'm a very good father. But I am a father. And You can't take that away from me, even on my worst days. And the Orthodox Church, what I found, it was the same. What happens when you step through the royal doors, what happens by the altar, is Orthodox. And you can have the most debauched, wayward priest, but he is not departing from the way, because it's beyond his strength to do so. And that is the action of the Holy Spirit, because when it comes to the human level, Orthodox are no better or no worse than anyone else. But if you're looking for worship, and you're looking for Christian content, and you're looking for divinely inspired worship instead of man-made worship, and you're looking for an orderly apostolic inheritance, you will find it within Orthodoxy. And so I soon decided for myself that, you know, I was home, and I knew that as I saw my first liturgy, as I told you, but practically I wanted to know how to come into the church. And so I called Father Chris and said, listen, I want to become Orthodox. And he said, okay, fine, you know, let's talk. Now, remember earlier I said to you that if you use the Protestant mentality, it's always this sort of panicked, in, out, saved, lost. If you're not in the church, you're lost. And the Protestant mentality is, hey, man, if someone's going to accept Jesus for their Savior, get him down on the sidewalk. Because if they're hit by a car 10 seconds later and they haven't said the magic prayer, they're vapor. So quick, quick. You know, ring the alarm bell. You're in or you're out. And I was expecting the same mentality. I was expecting, because we all just learn, you know, I didn't know anything about contemporary Orthodoxy. I thought he'd push me, he'd cajole me, it would be join now, tomorrow's too late, get your wife and kids here immediately. It would be the same way that as a Protestant, I would cajole people, fool them, trick them, do whatever I had to get them into the Christian family. You can dress it up any way you want, but that's the story. But I was amazed, because the first thing he told me was, look, the Orthodox Church has been here 2,000 years, and by God's grace, you may be around a few longer. Take your time. There's no particular rush. Okay, yeah, well, how do I join? Well, you know, when I'm satisfied as your priest that you have learned something about Orthodoxy, and when we've done some reading and some talking and praying, and you've come through the liturgy enough, then we'll talk about it. And in the meantime, the first thing I want to do is talk to your wife and find out how she feels. Well, what's that got to do with anything? Isn't it a matter of personal faith? He said, well, yeah, but you have to understand, we don't break our own rules. And one of the sacraments of the church is marriage. And you're not going to come into my Orthodox church if the price is smashing your family. So first, I want to talk to your wife. Well, this was a different deal than I'd ever run into. And I was sort of amazed, and I didn't fully understand it at that time. It was only later that you begin to understand that the mystery of salvation is indeed that. It's a mystery. It's not a black and white experience. It is a journey toward Christ, and it has to be a journey of the whole person. That's why Orthodoxy engages our bodies. It's not a mental journey. It's not something you feel. This is why we make our cross. This is why we venerate the icon. This is why we kiss the priest's hand. This is why we do things. Because it is the whole person who is being redeemed, and it is a journey and a process. It is not an in-out, black-white intellectual conception, a kind of an Augustinian rationalistic approach. And so I was quite amazed, and so he talked with my wife, Regina, and found that she was not adverse, though she was by no means at that point ready to sign on the dotted line. And so we proceeded, and I was chrismated at Christmas in 1990, and the following Easter, my wife, Jeannie, also was chrismated at Easter. And interestingly enough, a footnote, one of the reasons she didn't want to become Orthodox sooner is she too was waiting for the other shoe to drop. You see, she had been raised in a traditional Roman Catholic family in San Francisco. And she had been in high school when all the stuff came down from Vatican II. And she said, I've seen what happens to traditional liturgies. One morning I went to school and I had nuns in habits teaching me to fast on Friday, teaching me the prayers of the church, and I went back next week and they were in miniskirts saying they had disbanded the order and none of this matters anyway. And okay, so too bad, you've been doing this since you were three. You don't need to fast anymore, it's optional. And here, the liturgy's changed, it's now this way. And Jeannie said, look, I've seen it happen once, why won't it happen again? And what she had to do was meet some of the Greek women in our parish, and then she understood Orthodoxy would not change. Because the priest might or might not guarantee the tradition, but people like Thelma and Stella will. And we laugh and it's pleasantly amusing, but it also happens to be true because the priesthood of the believers in Orthodoxy have defended their faith, sometimes even against their own hierarchy, as in the iconoclastic controversy where for more than 100 years the Orthodox Church was dominated by heretics. And it was the people and the monks and the simple priests, because truly the Holy Spirit guides the church. It's not guided from Constantinople. We have no pope. It is the people. And the miracle is that while everything else has changed and the sands of time have eroded everything, the people of Orthodoxy, led by their bishops, led by their priests, led by their monks, have maintained the tradition. So you really can read Ugaira's Diary of a Pilgrimage, and you really can come to Holy Week in a couple of weeks here at this church, and you really will find the historical church. But it's been the Thelma and the Louises, as well as the saints and the bishops, who have guaranteed it. When I came into the Orthodox Church, my family came in after me. My son Francis, who's now just finishing up in university, was skeptical. He said, "Dad, you've been on this spiritual journey ever since I can remember. Every Sunday we come home from church, we're arguing about the sermon. You know, worship was non-existent in our family. It was all an intellectual exercise. And, you know, okay, you go for a few years and I'll see if you stay with it. And then I'll go. But I'm not going to," because I had taken him to some Roman Catholic churches and then I'd Episcopal. And they said, "Forget, my friends are at the local Episcopal church. I'm going to be going down there until you stay in one place long enough to want to see that." But out of curiosity, after a couple of months, he came to the Orthodox Church and he liked it. He didn't say much. And I hope I was wise in this, and I didn't push him. And month went by, he came back again, and a few weeks he came back again, and then he came every Sunday for a month. And I said to him finally, he was 16 at the time, and I said, why aren't you going down to the Episcopal Church where anymore? Well, you're coming here every month. He said, "Well, put it this way, it's very difficult for me, but once you've seen the real thing, the imitation isn't going to cut it anymore." And I never told him that. But he was real Christian and desirous to be in a real church. And once you've been in the Orthodox liturgy for a few Sundays, it's very, very hard. You're amazed how quickly you become Orthodox in your heart. You go back, it seems trivial and light and strange. This has been the experience of many people. My daughter Jessica, who's now married, at the time was in NYU in New York, and she says, "I have a boy I want you to meet." And I was thinking, oh, there you go. She's left home and in college before I've had a chance to talk to her really about Orthodoxy. She's been away during these years, and now she's met some guy, and she says he's a Christian, but obviously, you know, I hope and pray, but, you know, what kind of a Christian? And he may take her in the other direction, and so forth and so on. And the boy she met had grown up in an Assemblies of God church in Finland, in Europe, and now he was studying in New York, and he came up to the house for me to meet him, and he walked in the door, and I greeted him, and so forth, and, you know, prospective father-in-laws, prospective son-in-laws, the son-in-law thinks he's nervous. Well, there's no book on how you're supposed to deal with this. My first reaction was just to get a shotgun and kill him, because who wants their daughter to meet some guy at college you know nothing about and say she's serious enough to bring him home? Better just shoot the sucker and leave it at that. But Jeannie is so happens talked me out of it, said it would be, instead of shooting him, you know, have coffee first, then shoot him. But he walked into the house and he looked down at my coffee table and he looked at a book I had been reading and he says, "Oh, I see you're reading... I see you're reading The Primacy of Peter by Meyendorf." He said, "Yeah, you know, last week I just finished reading something by Schmemann on the Eucharist." Now, if you're Orthodox, you'll know that these are two great Orthodox theologians of the 20th century. And I sort of heard him for a second and then said to him, "What did you just say?" He said, "Well, you know, Schmemann's a little easier to understand than Meyendorf, but," he says, "you know, the one I like best is Ferofsky. You ought to be reading Ferofsky." So I gave him a double take, and I said, "Well, what do you know about all this?" And he said, "Well, you know, I grew up in a Pentecostal family, and he, by the way, was studying in a music academy, composition in New York, and he said, "But ever since I was a little child, you know, an Orthodox church down the road, a Russian Orthodox church, I would be sneaking in to listen to the choir." And he said, "You know, as a musician, I don't have to tell you what spoke to me more, an Orthodox Byzantine chant in the Russian mode or my local tambourine banging. This is a guy, he's a classical pianist. So he said I would sneak in and listen, and I developed a great warmth and an affinity for Orthodoxy, and sometimes when my parents wouldn't know because they thought they were all a bunch of idolaters and would have killed me, I'd actually go to a Vesper service or something, and then I found myself going, not because I wanted to hear the music, but because I missed the church. And then I grew up and sort of lost interest and moved to New York, and I rented an apartment in a part of New York called Astoria. Now, to those of you who are Greek, you will know that Astoria is the Greek community in America par excellence. Everybody settled in Astoria. And he said, I didn't know what had happened. He says, I thought I had an apartment in New York to study music. And he says, it was like I'd moved to Greece. I couldn't even find anybody on my street that spoke English. And he said, every other corner has an Orthodox church on it. So I started going to the local Orthodox church again. And he said, oh, you're interested in Orthodoxy. Jessica told me that's wonderful. He says, I'm really moving in that direction myself. So then I said to Jeannie, now where's that bottle of champagne we've been keeping around? What do you mean we're only going to serve this guy coffee? You know, come in here. Jessica, this is a wonderful man. So anyway, they got married, and the next year, he and my wife, his wife, my daughter, were married and then were chrismated the following year in a small Antiochian Orthodox church here in California. And so my two grandchildren that she's born since then, this was 4 years ago, are the first people in my family to be born, quote, into the church. So in our clan, we have converts and we also have ethnic Orthodox in our family, people born into the church. So, and my youngest son, John, who was 8 at the time we came in, like all children, didn't need to have anything explained to him. He just wanted to know how you can serve at the altar. Because thank God for the Orthodox church that gives us an iconography and incense and candles. And, you know, you always leave an Orthodox church with wax on your shoes and oil on you and water sprinkled and the smell of basil and incense. And children understand immediately and instinctively that they, as a human being, are being appealed to. You know, how many times did I have to sit listening to long Presbyterian sermons when my mother, God bless her, had to create her own fake iconography for me? Because you know what Mom would do? She actually, in her heart, was very Orthodox. She'd sit drawing pictures of the Bible characters and the people that the sermon was about, so her 6 and 7 and 8 year old children would not get fidgety in 2 hour sermons. And she'd illustrate the sermon for me. Well, talk about reinventing the wheel. The Orthodox Church understands the iconography, and it's not just this kind of icon, it's the vestments the priests wear. One of the great experiences of my life was to go into the great Orthodox Church of Santa Apollinaria in Siena in Italy, and there you see the priests in the vestments of the 4th to 6th centuries, and it looks like my church on Sunday morning. It's the same continuity. There is the andidero and the bread being held in the hands of the priest. There is the censer that he could have borrowed it from my priest, and all of a sudden you say, this is the historical church. It isn't just me and my Bible and my conscience. I am not alone. And that's a tremendous thing for someone who has been in the desert of individualism. I am not alone. I walk on a well-trodden path. I'm not beating my own trail through the woods. Others have gone before me. Others are following behind. I am not by myself with my own conscience. My priest will tell me what the tradition of the church has been. The liturgy and the Eucharist and the communion of the church isn't different for Frank Shaeffer and Ben Smith. It's the same. And you know what? Those Christians from 4th century Ravenna could come to my church or I could go to theirs. And we would know where we were in each other's services. This is something bigger than the sum of its parts. It doesn't depend on whether the local priest is a nice guy. It doesn't depend on whether I got touchy-feely spiritual feelings. I don't have to try to go on fishing expeditions for the blessing of the Holy Spirit and his indwelling. I don't have to approach this as an individual quest. I am in the community of faith, and this community of faith is the body of Christ on earth. It is the Christ-bearing community. This is the church. And so for me, the experience of Orthodoxy has been a tremendous blessing. Now, I would just say that if you read my book, Letters to Father Aristotle, especially those of you who are Orthodox, you're going to find that it's far from a rosy picture here in this country. Why? Well, the Orthodox Church in the Soviet Union was the true church, but it was infiltrated with KGB bishops that had been put there by plants to replace the saintly bishops and priests who had been executed. People were worshiping in basements. People got killed from their faith. There were traitors and betrayals in the church at the same time, just as there were in the early church. It was a mess in human terms. And yet out of the rubble of the Soviet Union rises what? The church. Because it is greater than the sum of its parts. And the monasteries, over 880 monasteries, are full to the bursting. And there are too many baptisms and chrismations for the priests. They literally are so tired in their labors that they're trying to rush people through seminaries to get more of them in the field. Because the church survives and goes on. Well, similarly, here in this country, if you read my book, Letters to Father Aristotle, you're going to find essays lamenting the deadness in some of our Orthodox churches. You're going to find essays lamenting the fact that the ethnic inheritance of our church here in America did not bring a missionary zeal with it, that it did build the church here as an institution and perform a miracle by the blood, sweat, and toil of the first generation. But they did not come as St. Herman of Alaska came, or Cyril and Methodius came, or the Apostle Paul came. They came the way all the rest of us came to America, or our parents or grandparents, if we're Americans, and that is to succeed and to make a buck. And that inheritance has infiltrated Orthodoxy. And there are a great many Orthodox who stumble through the motions, who have no idea whatsoever beyond the fact that because they're Greek or because they're Syrian or Lebanese, they're, quote, Orthodox. And this is a tragedy in the same way it would have been a tragedy to be in Russia at the time when your priest was a KGB plant. But the Orthodox Church is greater than the sum of its parts, and so you will also find in Letters to Father Aristotle essays talking about the love and the vibrancy and the beauty, not of individual communities only, but of the whole movement. And one of the great witnesses to the historic church is its monastic inheritance. I was amazed a few years ago. I had the privilege of spending a few days on Mount Athos in Greece, the great monastic community there in Greece that has some 20 monasteries on this peninsula that's like an island. It's almost cut off from the mainland. And there at Simonos Petra, being able to live there for just a few days with the monks and see that the tradition of worship and piety within Orthodoxy that has so faded away and been unknown in the West ever since the time of Martin Luther, and in the Western Christian church of Rome has also faded away in our new modern touchy-feely church where we have nuns and monks without habits, where we have orders dedicated to social work rather than prayer, where we've got this whole weird amalgam of kind of a humanistic mindset, where you would think monasticism is just another social agency of the federal government sometimes. That here on Mount Athos there were people who were getting up at 3 in the morning to pray, and if you said, what are you doing here? Why are you here? They wouldn't come back and say, well, you know, we make candles or icons or we're educating this, or no utilitarian answer. We're here for the salvation of our souls. What are you spending your day doing? Praying for the world. And here I came from a tradition out of Le Brie in Switzerland, where God bless my parents, where, speaking of reinventing the wheel, I had grown up in this Christian home where, because of their piety, they had days of prayer and fasting on a regular basis. Every Monday was a day of fasting, and you would sign up for prayer. And in their own way, walking by the light they were given, they were, unknown to themselves, reinventing the monastic tradition of the hours of prayer, that someone is keeping the prayers. And yet here within Orthodoxy, this great treasure really exists. And here in America, we now see the beginning of a true monastic movement, where in Arizona, and in Alaska, and in Oregon, and on the East Coast, and in other places, there are Russian, and there are Greek communities, and others as well, Romanian, and right across the board of Orthodox, who are beginning to live the monastic life, usually and hopefully under the guidance of someone who really knows what they're doing and has been in a real Orthodox monastic community. And so all of a sudden, the very spiritual experience, that kind of dynamic spirituality that the Pentecostal movement and the charismatic movement has tried to recreate, much as my parents, God bless them, tried to recreate at Le Brie, days of fasting and prayer and a true belief in the Holy Spirit. Here within Orthodoxy, like a precious jewel hidden in the center of a package, wrapped in another package, in another package, in another package, you unstrip it, and what you find is the real power of the Holy Spirit in the lives of the people, like the saints, like Saint Seraphim of Sarov, who spent 1,000 days and night on a rock crying, "Lord, have mercy," and was seen literally by secular witnesses with no axe to grind in the forest, glowing with the uncreated light, filled with the Holy Spirit, outpouring the love of Christ, literally transformed, deified, theosis in this life. And so here you have this church of bricks and mortar and history and people, and yet at the heart of it a spiritual dynamic that literally has been lost to Western Christianity, and for which so many Christians, charismatic and others, have struggled by trying to reinvent outside of the apostolic succession these tremendous spiritual truths. And the difference between the Orthodox saints that we look to in the church and the self-created reinventing of the wheel is simply this. It is that within the church, we are always told that these gifts are not things that we seek individually in the sense that we demand them of God. They are part of a journey that one comes to after a lifetime of struggle. And that the 1,000 day and nights on the rock has to come first before this, quote, spiritual gift is suddenly just claimed. That it is, take up your cross and follow me. And the cross for each life must come before the resurrection in some way. And so what you find within Orthodoxy is the best of what you might call the true charisma of the church. And yet it is within the orderly structure that defends against the chaos, the insanity, and the heresy of self-made reinvention of the wheel. And that's not to say that there's nothing good about people who have tried the self-invention anymore. There's not to say that there aren't loving couples living in harmony together who are not married and who are simply sleeping with their boyfriend or girlfriend, and yet because they are created in the image of God and they do love each other, there are many attributes in the relationship which are beautiful and they love each other. And they might bear a child and raise that child, and yet from a Christian perspective, beautiful and true as this might be, it is outside of the framework as designed by the living God. And so within Orthodoxy, you find the great saints of the church, like Seraphim of Sarov, submitting humbly to bishops and to abbots of monasteries who sometimes were even jealous of their spiritual power. And yet the real saints say that they learn more by submitting to the bishop whose motivation was wrong and all the rest of it, because obedience taught them more about the actual true nature of Christ and how to imitate him than necessarily always being right and winning every argument, but living in such arrogance and with a lack of humility that you really in the end were further away from God even though you were, quote, right. And so you find a tradition of humility within Orthodoxy, not because Orthodox are more humble than other people, but because by God's grace the monastic movements have been preserved. And so within Orthodoxy you will find the great writers and the teachers and these others. But in the end, it will all come back to one holy monk or nun living and trying to imitate Christ. And the life of Christ shows through that person. And I must say, I personally have experienced that. I'm not one given to much personal experiential anecdote. I don't trust it. You know, as a writer, I write novels. And one of the touchstones of my life is something I heard, someone who said, and it sums it up for me, that the one kind of writing to really avoid when you're writing fiction, never write when you're feeling inspired, because it's going to turn out to be garbage. You're so feeling inspired, and this is clever and creative, and you're writing. You know, the best writing I've ever done in my life is the writing I do when I simply get up, it's Monday morning, sit down, write something, because you're a writer, you have to be disciplined. At the time, it doesn't look that good, but you do it, one foot in front of the next. That's always a lot better. You know, the stuff I've done where I've had a great idea has always been problematic. You're carried away by your own euphoria so often. And spirituality is no different. The spirituality that is forged in the flames of obedience within the Orthodox life brings a totally different result. People are not sent out alone. You know, the great hermits don't go out into the desert until they've paid their dues within the monastic community for 15, 20, or 30 years. And finally, maybe they're said, okay, now you are spiritually ready to, as it were, see the face of God, to go there onto the mountain, to be alone. But it isn't something you do casually and individually. And so for me, in coming into Orthodoxy, one of the things that I personally have experienced, and you can believe it or not believe it, is this, and I would sum it up this way. If you think about that passage where Christ is talking to Thomas, and Thomas doubts the risen Lord, and Christ says to him, well, you've seen and you've touched, and so you believe, but blessed are they who are going to come along who do not see and touch, and yet believe. I've got to tell you something honestly. Christ is not talking about me at that point, because I have been in the place of Thomas. I have literally seen and touched the living Christ. Where? In the person of the very few holy, orthodox, old, because it takes a lifetime, monastics that I've had the privilege of meeting in a very few spots. And I have literally been in the presence of Christ. And I'm not talking about some touchy-feely analogy that I felt love or anything like this. These are tough-minded people often. But there are two monks in particular that I had the privilege of meeting on Athos. And there's a nun I met in Jerusalem. And there's a nun that I correspond with by letter, and a monk I correspond with by letter that I have not met. And in those people, I am literally talking to Christ. That does not mean they're popes or they're perfect. They will tell you they are the worst sinners in the world. Their only prayer is, Lord, have mercy. But I have looked into the face of Christ. And you know, I met someone the other day who I interviewed for the Christian Activist. Some of you may have read the interview. Someone by the name of Dr. Kimberly Patton, who teaches at the Harvard Divinity School, believe it or not. So don't nuke Boston yet. And Kimberly is a brilliant scholar. She's the youngest female professor there at Harvard. And she was brought up in a Unitarian family, doesn't believe anything, basically. And she was teaching in Harvard at the comparative religion. And her field, her doctorate, is on the history of sacrifice as told in Greek vases, in the images on Greek vases from the classical period. And she was teaching, that's a train, by the way, those of you listening on the tape. It isn't the last trumpet, you know, it's okay. She was teaching at the Harvard Divinity School, and she met someone there by the name of Demetrius Trakatellas. And Demetrius Trakatellas is a bishop in the Orthodox Church who also happens to be a world-renowned professor of Old Testament who teaches at the Harvard Divinity School, and also at that time was teaching at Holy Cross Seminary. And Demetrius is a true monk in his heart. If you met him, and you know, you would have to be told he's a bishop, because he would be the humblest and most kindest person you'd ever met. Completely self-effacing. And I said to Kimberly, you know, what brought you into the Orthodox Church? And she said, well, the journey started in two places, and this is how I'll conclude this talk. Kimberly's an intellectual, okay? Now, this would be the person who'd read all the books and be convinced and come in. Forget the books. Kimberly came into the Orthodox Church because two of experiences unlooked for. The first was she was teaching at the Harvard Divinity School, and there's a lot of infighting in the faculty and backstabbing, and, you know, the higher you get up in the world of academics, the worse it gets. I mean, they make rock stars look fairly selfless. And in this community and in this environment, you know, she was just felt very prickly and very hostile because it's all this. I mean, especially places where the feminist ideology dominates your particular campus, because these are the bitterest people on the face of the earth. By the time you get into the Harvard Divinity School, you're made of gall and vinegar. And this is Kimberly telling me this. So she was not only not a Christian, but disappointed with the whole experience of Christianity as manifested there, and beyond that, just very disillusioned with the idea of religion altogether. And all of a sudden she said, this presence floats into the campus, and I see this old man coming up a hallway in a robe with a long stringy beard, and it's, who's this guy? And I start talking to him, and they say, oh, well, he teaches at Holy Cross, and he comes on loan to do Old Testament studies. He lectures on Old Testament in the Divinity School. They bring him in because he's a world-renowned scholar. And she struck up a tremendous friendship with Demetrius Trakatellas, and the way she describes it is, suddenly I was confronted by the presence of a Christ who I did not even believe in. And yet I met him in this person. And so I suddenly began to wonder, well, maybe there is something really here. Because if this man can be so different than everything around him in the environment of the Harvard Divinity School, I've got to rethink who I am and what I believe, because maybe I can't just write off Christianity so quickly. What made her begin to think that way? It was the presence of Christ, and as she put it, she said, he would look at you the way you would imagine Christ would look at you. Well, a little time after that, she went to Greece to do some archaeological studies, and some friends of hers who were Greek Orthodox were having a baptism. And she went up to this little monastic community on a hillside, a typical Greek adventure where the great-grandmother is being carried in a sedan chair under an umbrella, and it takes the whole village half a day to get her to the place, and so forth and so on, and totally inefficient and crazy. That's one thing I love about the Orthodox Church. It always has that slightly insane quality to it, which suits me down to the T. So they're all going up here on this pilgrimage, and it's for the child's baptism, and so the godparents are carrying a big white candle, and to amuse the child, they have taped a big pink bunny rabbit to it. And they're all going up to this ancient 10th century chapel, a little white chapel on the top of a cliff. It takes the whole day. It looks as if the people carrying the sedan chair all have a heart attack. Kimberly's saying, this is insane. They get up there, and it's a tiny little baptistry, and this old monk comes stumbling out to perform the service, and the people she's with are quite secular. They are the kind of chrismated and baptized Orthodox who are not, quote, Orthodox, that we Western Christians would judge for a lack of zeal. So this isn't even, you know, this isn't an environment of the best of all possible worlds, nothing like that. And the baptism began, and Kimberly said suddenly she was struck by the actual presence of the Holy Spirit. And she said, I can't describe it any other way. And I said, well, what do you mean? And she said, well, I know you think I sound crazy. But she said, I heard the echoes of 1,000 years of prayers that had been prayed in that spot. And I could feel the presence of all those people who had brought their children for 1,000 years to be baptized into the church. And I could sense their prayers, and I could sense the presence of the Holy Spirit. And that experience with her meeting Demetrius Trakatellas, a true living saint, was enough to take a pretty tough young woman teaching in the Harvard Divinity School that's about as far away from Orthodoxy as you can get, in a community that, if anything, had jaded her vision of not only life, but even of the idea of religion. By bad example, these, you know, kind of backbiting faculty, fist-in-your-face feminism, me, and the experience of meeting someone who came from that monastic walk of life combined with seeing this liturgical manifestation of the Holy Spirit in baptism was enough not to make her Orthodox on the spot, but to start a train of events wherein she was chrismated a couple years ago and is an Orthodox Christian now, and her husband is being chrismated this Pascha into the church. And these, if you had to sort of, I don't know if those of you know about places like the Harvard Divinity School, but I promise you, if you had to come up with a scenario of the person who the church could never touch, it wouldn't be me, because I was raised in a community that believed certain things, but you'd say, okay, let me see. That's East Coast. Let's make it a woman. Let's make her the youngest professor in Harvard. Let's make it the Divinity School. Let's make it comparative religion. And let's make this in 1990s. There's the impossible person. And you know, my lecture never would have brought Kimberly one inch closer to the church. My books would have driven her perhaps in the other direction. I'm not as smart as Kimberly Patton by a long shot. But the way Demetrius Trakatellas talked to her, and the light she saw literally in his eyes, and the presence of the Holy Spirit in a small white chapel on a cliffside on an island in Greece, brought her into the church. And in the fundamental work that I do of perhaps speaking of Orthodoxy to some of you here today, you know, my role is only that, if anything, of getting someone interested enough or aggravated enough to see what the Orthodox Church actually has. There's a really big difference between the sort of talks I would give here and what I used to say as a Protestant, and I'll tell you what it is. In my Protestant incarnation a few years ago, if I had been in a similar group here speaking, let's say this was a college campus and I was just talking about Christianity itself, the theory would be the part that sounded good. My lecture would be the thing that sounded good, just as a Billy Graham crusade sounds good. And when it was done, people would come up to me and say, well, maybe I'm ready to think about Christianity. This would be to a non-Christian crowd. What do I do now? Then came the hard part, because you couldn't really tell them to go to church, because you didn't know what church to send them to. You didn't know the pastor. You didn't know the craziness that went on. You knew the pastor didn't answer to anybody. If he sets a bad example and runs off with the secretary, they may or may not pitch him out. He can preach just about any theology he wants. If he's charismatic, he says, Jesus laid it on my heart. If he's from Reformed, I studied it in seminary, no one's going to hold him accountable. So the hard part was, what do you do with someone who wants to be a Christian in the late 20th century? For me, I guess the biggest change in that part of my life, having become Orthodox, is now is it's the easiest part. Because I'll tell you something, for anyone who is interested in the Orthodox Church, you can say, well, if you have this specific question, read this book and so forth. But there is a there, because I'll be honest with you. For those of you who are Protestant and thinking about Orthodoxy, I don't want you to sign up on the dotted line or commit your heart to Jesus or get my newsletter or buy my book. Well, maybe buy the book. I'm an author, after all. It always is good to buy books. You don't have to read it. They make great doorstops. But there's a there, because at the end of the day, when someone comes up to me at my little book table and says, I'm interested in Orthodoxy, what do? I have a very simple answer. Find your local Orthodox church and start going to liturgy. Yeah, but then what do I read? What? Find your local Orthodox church and go to liturgy. Yeah, but I mean, after that, you know, the film series, the this, the tape, the thing. No, find your local Orthodox church and go to liturgy. And the only way I would qualify it is I would say the first few times you're going to be like me, like a tourist looking around. You won't know what anything is, so you're going to be saying, "What? This looks like this, this looks like that." Go to liturgy for enough time, a couple of months. Go to Vesper services. We're coming now up to Holy Week, Pascha. The most wonderful time of the Orthodox Church is approaching now. We're in Lent, preparing for the resurrection of Christ. Any person who, with an open heart, who was a Christian, and I literally mean any person who was a Christian with an open heart, from whatever background, who went to the Pascha week celebration beginning in Holy Week, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, by the time you come up to Resurrection Sunday, by the time you are there at the service on Saturday night, you will have gone through the whole gospel. You would have heard all the prophecies of the Old Testament read. You have prayed the prayers of the psalmist. You have in tears repented of your own sins, as we hear in the words of the wisdom of the church, a whole night given to the repentance of the sinful woman. The church does not forget those who have come through her before we have, and you will find that we gloss things over so often in our rush to theologize, but because worship is often not there, the treasure, the still small voice, is not heard. And so I would simply say to those of you who are interested in Orthodoxy, you say, well, what's the program? What do I do next? There is nothing more to do than to take advantage of the treasure that the Orthodox Church is, and to go to liturgy, to go to prayers in the Orthodox Church, and to go for long enough so you're no longer a tourist, but in the words of C.S. Lewis, the glory of the liturgy is that it fits like an old slipper. It's a seamless garment. You're not self-aware. You're not noticing everybody around you. You're not caught up in something in that sense. It's like a seamless slipper. It's that well-trodden path. It's the opposite of the me generation and ego and making it up as you go along and what you feel and my experience. What you are doing is humbly sharing in the experience of not only those believers near you, but the whole church, both in heaven and on earth as it worships before the throne. And so I suppose you might say the proof of the historical church, although I don't mean it in that sense, is simply the historical church itself. Not words about it, but what it really is. And the essence of the historical church is not the annual food festival, and it's not the Hellenistic tradition, and it's not keeping alive the Arab and Antiochian and Lebanese tradition in your community, and it's not American individualism and people converting and suddenly, you know, you have a priest and he's out there doing. It's the common inheritance of all of us that transcends those things. And for those of you who have the privilege to taste some of that, you'll very soon find that, like my middle son, Francis, when you try to go back and dip into worship without orthodoxy, you too will say, it's very hard to go back once you've seen the real thing. And so I would close there and solicit some questions.
Is it fair to suggest that you, when you're doing your research and finding out about the historical church, that coming from your perspective of the Protestant background, you may have been thrown a curveball or two in terms of how you've been presented all this information over time? If that's true, how do you deal with that?
Let me rephrase your question and correct me if I'm wrong. The question is, coming to Orthodoxy as I did, and given my Protestant background, how do I deal with the fact that I may have been told things about the historic church that are not true? He's putting his thumb up, so that must be what he wanted. And how do I deal with what you might call misinformation? Well, I'd simply like to say this. Those of you who have read any church history written in the 19th or 20th century, people like Harnack, for instance, know that there's a tremendous bias against the Orthodox East in a lot of Western church history. Why? Because while the Reformers rebelled against a great deal of corruption in the Roman Catholic Church, they swallowed hook, line, and sinker the Western Roman Catholic papal propaganda about the East, or as they would like to call it, the withered branch of the Church. And I'll tell you why. You have to understand something. Protestantism does not worry the Roman Catholic Church. It doesn't worry it, and never has, because you can rebel against Catholicism, but the Church can still claim, look what happened to you Protestants. You rebelled, and now our worst prophecy is fulfilled. 23,000 denominations, schismatics, sectarian Christianity, your theology's all over the map. You need the papacy to anchor the faith. You need a central hierarchy. But the very existence of Orthodoxy for 2,000 years is a horrible challenge to the Roman Catholic Church in exactly the same way that the very existence of a democratic Taiwan is a terrible challenge to the communist leadership of China. Why? Because the communist leadership of China look at Singapore and they say, Singapore has a dictatorship like us. We're Asians. Why should we have this European idea of human rights imposed on us? We have a different kind of a culture. It could never work here. We need a central authority. We need a hierarchy. We need this structure. That's great for England and France and Italy, but it can't work for Asian culture. Well, the very existence of a vibrant democratic state like Taiwan, forget what they do, just their existence, is a horrible challenge to that. Because here are Chinese living in the same geographical area. They did not come from the West. They're not imports. They're as Chinese as anybody sitting in Beijing. And yet, here's a society that holds out the hope for someone like Hong Kong that Asians aren't different, that Asians are human beings who like to have some freedom and who like to live in a society that's not tyrannized by a central authority. And so the very existence is a challenge. Well, similarly, in the West, you have to understand something. The Roman Catholic line on Protestantism is, see, they fulfilled our worst case scenario. If it's the Pope, you have order with all the problems. Yes, there's the tyranny, the papal armies, invasions of countries, split papacy in Avignon. Yes, the horror stories are all true, but there's always something worse. And that's modern schismatic Protestantism. Look where it got you. Modern theology, higher critical methods of biblical study, all imported through Protestantism. And that's a pretty good argument, except when you say, yeah, but there's another alternative. You can have the historical church, you can have hierarchical functions of apostolic inheritance, you can have liturgy, and here, irony of ironies, this non-papal church has its ancient liturgies and theology more intact than the papal church. And so, beginning right back when the two bodies began to grow apart from the 8th century on, and it culminated in a rift between the Byzantine Orthodox Church in the East. Well, it was all over Europe. It was in Italy, too. So it wasn't just an Eastern Church and the Western Church. And they grew apart over the issue of the papacy and some theological concerns, the filioque and so on. But it was basically an issue of papal authority. What you have to understand is the very existence of the Orthodox Church has been a challenge to the Western mind. And so you are not going to find unbiased and neutral Western histories. The Protestants have not done their own research, with a very few examples that are exceptions. They've simply bought the typical Western Roman line. The Roman Catholics themselves know nothing about the Eastern Church. Now you've got a weird thing kind of reversed, where you have a modern pope saying, let's be rejoined in an ecumenist movement to Orthodoxy. And so, well, even if the Orthodox won't let us receive communion in their church, they can come to our church and receive communion, kind of undermining the authority of Orthodoxy. It's another way to do the same thing. It's just the velvet glove instead of the nailed fist. It's the same impulse. But the West doesn't know what to do with Orthodoxy. Protestants don't know what to do with it, because here you have the historical church, and you can read Ugaira and the others, and nobody can claim that it isn't. So an atheistic Jewish anthropologist is going to say, all Christians are deluded. But it is a historic fact that the ones that have been deluded in the same way for the longest time are the Orthodox. That's history. All right? That's history. So the West doesn't know what to do with us. Because if the Orthodox Church is the Orthodox Church, why aren't all the Protestants eager to join it? Well, I'll tell you why. If they're like me, it's out of ignorance. They don't know much about it. But many that do know something about it cannot give up their own sovereignty. They want to be the final authority. They want to lead the Monday morning Bible study, and it's got to be what Jesus laid on my heart. And they can dress it up any way they want, but they do not wish to join the community of believers, because they are no longer their sovereign, isolated, primary authority on everything. The buck doesn't stop with Frank Shaeffer. It stops with his priest, Christopher Festucus, his bishop, Methodius, and the other bishops of the Orthodox Church. And that's not something that you want to come to easily as a Protestant, when, you know, you can get up to anything you want about any subject at any time, and you're free to do so. It's a matter of a lack of humility. And so the East is a thorn in the flesh to the West by its very existence. And so in terms of misinformation, you're going to find two kinds. You're going to find the kind of typical scenario of just total ignorance. And one can't blame someone for that, because we're taught that history is unimportant in America. The basketball coach teaches history in our high schools. We're an ahistorical society. The past is just a yardstick against which the glorious technological future can be measured. We don't even know our own history. History, schmistry, you know, I want to learn computer science so I can make money. Let's get real. Now, added to that, you have Protestant misinformation that is rooted back into Roman Catholic hostility. And when you put all that together, no one knows anything about Orthodoxy in this country. And so, yeah, there has been it's a difficult passage to make, because you really have to be willing to start at ground zero and say, I'll read Eusebius, and then I'll go to an Orthodox church and see if this is this. I'll read Ugaira, and then I'll come to this church on Holy Week, and I'll see if what she's writing about is still happening. I'll listen to what the council said about the Trinity, and next time I hear an Orthodox preach on a sermon on this, I'm going to see if he's preaching a German 19th century higher critical sermon where the Holy Spirit and this and this and this are just a figment of our imagination, or I'll see if he's preaching with the historic church. And you can begin to make your comparisons. And on that basis, with an open mind, I think a lot of people would at least come to the place my atheist anthropologist friends would come to when they say, yeah, you're all deluded, but at least the Orthodox have consistently been deluded from the beginning. This other stuff is a new religion often. Now, if you're a Christian and you're following Christ, the question then becomes the one that obviously I had to ask myself, and that is, given that I am now convinced that this is the Orthodox Church, if I can find one near me, why aren't I in it? And if all I can say is, oh, well, you know, 50% of this thing is in Greek, or they're not as nice to me, but hey, on that basis, I'd worship at my car wash. I get good service, it's in English. They want my business. You know, they've got, in the summer, there's girls out there in snappy uniforms cleaning my windshield. It's great. It's a good feeling. They play music. But if worship is an encounter with the living God in which one has to lay one's ego aside, if humility is part of the approach, then the last place I want to be is somewhere putting on a show to stroke me and my ego and make me feel good. That's the last thing I'd be looking for. And so, you know, Orthodoxy, yeah, it has a lot of problems. Read letters to Father Aristotle, you'll find out that it's going to fight its battles against secularism in our culture just like everybody else has. And we're going to be sifted very finely and we will stand or fall. We've lost a lot of the second generation because of a type of Orthodoxy that thinks that Orthodoxy consists of being baptized, chrismated, and then going to church on Easter. We have all kinds of problems, but thank God, miraculously, and really so in this culture where everything's now polluted, what happens here is the real thing. And if you're in church for the show and the stroking and the this and that, you will be disappointed by Orthodoxy. There's all kinds of super churches. You can go down the street here. Bob Schuller will do a much better job of uplifting you every Sunday. But as a matter of fact, you know, there are a lot of psychologists who will do an even better job. So just go lie on a couch and take Valium. You'll feel even better. Every day you will feel better about yourself. Better and better and better and better. But if worship is not to make you feel better, but to bring you to repent before Christ and beg his mercy, if it is to put you in the historical stream trod by the feet of the saints and martyrs from the beginning, then the Orthodox Church is the last best hope. And it is where that tradition has been maintained. Yes?
You were saying you saw Christ and those folks up on Mount Athos, the monastics, and the nuns.
Right.
Mentioned here there was a monk who was praying for Judas for his whole life.
Yes.
In the Gospel, Christ said, when did we see you hungry or
sure.
thirsty and naked and not feed clothe and all you? And so how can you reconcile
sure.
spending your whole life being insensitive to the hungry, the
sure.
The people right next to you,
yes.
and being focused on the salvation of Judas
sure.
your whole life?
It's a good question. Let me repeat it. The question is, okay, so you have monks praying and nuns praying their whole life. How can you do this and reconcile it to the needs of the world? You know, you're sitting next to the hungry or the unclothed, and you're talking about prayer, and yet, you know, you're praying, but nobody's getting fed, or, you know, the water isn't being purified, or whatever you need to do. That's a very good question. I'd make some comments. First, let me make a historical comment. A lot of people in the West don't know this, but obviously the whole idea of philanthropy as we understand it comes out of the historic church. It is no coincidence that our hospitals are named things like St. Jude, St. Thomas's. You don't find very many St. Darwin's and St. Freud's. Secularism has not produced Western philanthropy. Christianity did. When we talk about the rights of man coming out of the Renaissance and the Enlightenment, when Voltaire and Rousseau and Turgot all held forth on the rights of the individual, they were borrowing Christian ideas, stripping the theology out, and leaving the humanistic core of treating people as they are treated in the image of Christ. That's why when you go to India before the British get there, you don't find ambulances, you just find people dying on the roadside, because the idea of people created individually in the image of God with intrinsic worth doesn't mean that the culture was less human in other ways. Mothers were still mothers, mothers, fathers, fathers. But this Western philanthropic idea of doing good comes from the historic church. And so it's no coincidence the first record in history we have of a home for repentant prostitutes and their babies is in Orthodox Byzantium of the 5th century. It's no coincidence that the whole Byzantine and Orthodox philanthropic inheritance is the one that shaped modern Western culture's idea about building the hospital, having the hospice for the aged. The first philanthropic institutions the world knew in our Western sense come right out of the Byzantine Christian East and right out of the Orthodox West, because you have to understand, until they separated, it was the same entity. So the inheritance of philanthropy that is often claimed by non-Christians in our culture comes right out of the Christian era, and before that has its roots right back into the Jewish people, who were different because in Leviticus they were commanded by God to treat the stranger in their midst in a certain way. If you happened to stumble into the Canaanite camp, they'd slaughter you. If you went to Egypt, they'd enslave you. If you should be so lucky as to be a stranger in the believing portion of Israel during the times they were following God, you were treated like royalty. And so was the infant, so was the orphan. The widow, her boundaries were protected. Because of the enlightenment of God to the Jews and the fact that the Christian tradition at its best carried this on, we have philanthropy. Now, when you come to the modern age and you look at what a monk does in this light, you have to understand two things. First of all, the church says different people are called to different things. The church is still building hospitals. Take the Orthodox Church, both in Kenya and in Nigeria and all over the world. You have not only mission efforts, but philanthropic efforts you do right here in America. If you look at the charities, for instance, in the Antiochian Church and the hospital in Beirut, these are some of the finest institutions in the world, and they're done in the name of Christ, and they're done by Orthodox Christians. So it's not an either-or situation. But now I want to come to a very important thing, having said that. All that said, we Christians should not be utilitarian. The reason we're Christian is not to clean up the water and build hospitals. We're Christians because the living Christ has revealed himself to us. Prayer is not a waste of time. So for someone to say, well, you're just praying and this guy's feeding the poor, is as nonsense as it would have been to go to Christ, who we are told time and again left the multitude who wanted to be healed, would not heal, would not feed, would not preach, and he went into the wilderness to pray. Do we dare say Christ was wasting his time when he prayed, when the multitude was furious and saying, if you were the Son of God, why aren't you here healing the sick? And so what we see in the life of the Lord Jesus Christ is that prayer and worship was the foundation upon which ministry was built, and the two things were seen as going hand in hand. But when Jesus had to choose, such as in the Garden of Gethsemane, in the temptation in the 40 days of the wilderness, in the fact that out of 33 years, he only had a ministry for three. What was wrong with him? Couldn't he have been? He knew he was the Son of God. In the temple when he was 12, we hear that the Lord Jesus Christ said, I'm about my Father's business. Why didn't he go heal people? Why wasn't he restoring Israel? Why didn't he throw the Romans out? That's what the Pharisees wanted to know. Why didn't he build hospitals? Why did he heal so few when there were so many sick? What about the poor old Gadarene swine? That's no way to treat a nice pig. Now, why did not he use his divine powers to bring Judas to his senses? He knew Judas was going to commit suicide. How could he be that unliving? Well, the answer to all of this is that if you live in the spiritual realm, and if the Holy Spirit and prayer is real, then there is no hierarchy of values where doing good works and giving alms is some greater thing than a sincere prayer from the heart. We hear exactly the opposite. The thief on the cross is promised salvation. He spent a life of villainy. He's done nothing for anyone, and yet this day, through faith, he will be in paradise. Jesus didn't say, tough luck, pal, you didn't donate to the Red Cross. Where are the orphans and widows you helped? When you look at the centurion who had the greatest faith in Israel, obviously this faith wasn't evidence in philanthropy. He was part of an invading, conquering, brutal army. This is like looking at someone in the Nazi Wehrmacht in Munich and saying, behold, Nazi SS officer Schleiman has the greatest faith I found in Berlin. I'm telling you something, Christianity in its adherence to spiritual principles cannot be confused with Western materialistic utilitarianism. We do not do things because they are useful, make money, or clean water up. We do them because they are right in themselves. And the first thing we are taught to do as Christians is to pray. And so one of these things, I don't believe, can be set over against the other. If the Orthodox Church through its whole years had produced nothing but monastics alone in caves praying, while repentant prostitutes languished in the street because they wouldn't ply their trade, and so they starved, and the church just said, tough, you'd be able to say, well, where's the love of Christ in this? But it wouldn't be because you would be saying, prayer's a waste of time. You would be saying, well, how can this be right? The glorious thing about the church is that it has always combined both. And of course, I hastened ahead, that aspect is not unique to Orthodoxy. My grandparents were in the China Inland Mission that Hudson Taylor founded. And the China Inland Mission was based on prayer. Some of the most zealous evangelists of the church have been monks almost their whole lives and then have come out for a few years, like Seraphim of Sarov did when he finally opened his cell. And so even in the monastic life, there's a cycle. Even within the life of contemplation, sometimes there's a cycle. Someone comes in, they're in a monastery for 15 years, they pray, They become a hermit, and then God suddenly calls them to open their cell door, or like St. Herman of Alaska, to go to Alaska and evangelize. And someone who hears the word acts on it, because there are people in the Alouette tribe there who are dying of starvation, and they go and they ask other Christians to send up some potatoes, and they build a hospital. And this is all seen as a seamless garment. So we see in life of Christ the example for each person's walk. We can't all do what Christ did, because none of us are Christ. And so we see in the tradition of Orthodoxy that no one has ever postulated that the monk is wasting his time praying as if he should be, quote, doing something. If we believe in the living God, what more could we be doing? I have to say it, if put it in very personal terms, then I'll go to another question. But, you know, if I make a deal with a publisher for my paperback edition of Portofino, right, it's coming out this summer in paperback, that's great. My editor calls me up, I get a contract, I get a few dollars, terrific. I'm glad for the few dollars. She did something for me. All right? But if there is a priest or a holy monk who's not just saying it as a, you know, I'll pray for you, right? Like we all say it, we're all liars. I'll pray for you. We pray once and we forget the person. But if a holy monk or a priest says, I'm going to keep your name and remember you at the altar when I'm in my prayers. I mean this literally. Maybe I'm a fool, but I would, you know, my contract from Putnam is a lot less valuable to me than that promise, because Putnam will get me through the summer, okay? But the monk on Athos who's truly told me that for the rest of his days there, he's going to remember me in his prayers. When I at night pray, Lord have mercy, and wonder how someone like me can be saved, one of the only reasons I don't despair entirely in my own spiritual life, because it's a real rocky road, you know, I'm a bad, hard, arrogant, unsalvageable person. One of the only reasons I have any hope is because I can picture a couple of these monks and nuns, and I say, hey, if I'm in the list of their prayers, may I stand in their shadow on the day of judgment. And I'll tell you, pal, you know, Putnam's, the Red Cross, they aren't going to do it for me. Our great philanthropic institutions are not going to be there on that day. But if Sister Sinviti Ki, Sister Amelia Ni, if she will remember to pray for me, then the scripture itself tells us that the prayers of a righteous person avail much. And if the scripture says the prayers of a righteous person avail much, then when Sister Amelia Ni tells me she'll pray for me every day, and I happen to know that unlike me, who can talk a good game and then get on my plane and go home at night, you know, she's alone in her cell, having died to the world, having given up all her possessions. You know, I covet that more than anything else in my life, because the next best thing to being on the road to Christ yourself is having those who are illumined by the Holy Spirit praying for you. So to me, the basis of my own hope as a Christian, I don't mean, please don't wax theological and somebody jump up and say, well, what about the saving power of Jesus? They're saying, you know, you have to take this in the spirit it's given. I'm just talking personally. Is that if there are people who are righteous who will pray for you, you basically have a nuclear arsenal. You're not standing there alone with a handgun. You're backed up by something very powerful, totally beyond your means. But the tradition of the church is that righteousness is not instant. In the story of Zacchaeus, you know, he had to pay back what he'd stolen, and he had to live a righteous life. And if you checked in 40 years later, he would have had to still be living it. And so the great thing about the monastic who prays for the world, who prays for me, who prays for you, whether by name or not by name, is that unlike me, or unlike perhaps some of you, who can do one thing and be another way, the actual choice of the monastic life is the very thing that makes them Christ-like and brings them toward Christ and trains them to be that righteous person whose prayers avail much. None of us are created righteous. So it's not an either-or situation. The philanthropy of the church proves that beyond a shadow of a doubt. But if you really believe in the power of the Holy Spirit, to have a righteous person remembering you in prayer is the single most valuable thing that can happen to you. And one of the great things about the Orthodox Church is we don't forget our people. You know, we do memorial services for after you're dead. And we ask the saints to pray for us now. You know, we read in the book of Revelation that the saints are under the altar of God saying, how long, how long? They know our condition. And we pray and we ask them to help us so that this monastic prayer is not just a few monks on Athos. It's the whole church triumphant. It's our saints. It's our martyrs. It's the Lord Jesus Christ. It's the Blessed Theotokos, the Mother of God. It's Sister Emilienne. It's this monk. It's your priest. It's your mother-in-law. It's the little old lady in the parish. It isn't always, the lines aren't that clear. But within our own generation, what a gift to have monastic communities where prayer is so valued that it's, quote, all they do. In a world that knows the price of everything and the value of nothing because we're so utilitarian. Yes, question.
I'd like to talk about the scripture, go out to all the world and preach the gospel. And I have right here an Orthodox Bible, and it's only the Psalms and the New Testament, and it was actually brought by the evangelical movement within the Orthodox. And I'm saying, why is this only in English when it had 2,000 years of monks who can do the translation? And I am just like you. I actually stumbled across Orthodoxy, not because of what the Orthodox Church did, but because of actually what I did. I run a philosophy room in the internet, and I was going to a lot of Christian rooms, and they couldn't answer my questions because I discovered some things in linguistics and in history. And one guy said in this one Christian room, he says, oh, we don't do that here. All we do is worship God, go over to Orthodox. And I went to Orthodox, and I asked my questions, and this guy answered all my questions. He said, come over to Orthodox Church. And I'm right now going through catechism class, and I even talked to the monk, and he said, I asked him the same question. He says, the Orthodox Church is not interested in converts. We're supposed to be more like Christ, and then through what we are like, we draw them to it. And I'm not sure if I agree with that or not. There has to be a balance between taking the responsibility of spreading the word of God and also each of us to be called by the Holy Spirit and to find out what all this is.
Yeah, let me comment. The question's a good one. Basically, the gentleman's saying, you know, well, what about evangelism from what he knows of Orthodoxy, which you know, maybe I can correct some of your misunderstanding, but from what you know of Orthodoxy, it's weak in evangelism, you know, we just live by example, we're not interested in evangelism, whatever it might be. Okay, I would say a couple of things. First of all, anyone who reads letters to Father Aristotle is going to know that I am very critical of what I would call this kind of ethnic club Orthodoxy, where you would think that the highest sacrament is the annual food festival. If this is the Orthodox Church, you can keep it. There are better Greek restaurants, and I can get the food free because I know the owner. If that's it. So you're talking to the choir when you speak of a hard-heartedness of just saying, oh, you know, we'll stay in our little community, we don't need to reach out, and so forth and so on. But I have to say something. If you think that's what even contemporary Orthodoxy is, let alone historic Orthodoxy, then you're misinformed, as many people are. First of all, the only reason any Christian is sitting in this room, Protestant, Roman Catholic, Pentecostal, Charismatic, you name it, is because of the Orthodox Church. The Bible was not preserved for 20 centuries and for the first centuries of the church under persecution by Baptists. The New Testament was not written by Presbyterians. The saints and martyrs of the church who handed down the belief in the Trinity were not charismatics. They weren't Americans. They weren't Anglo-Saxons. They were Greeks. And they were Syrians. And Lebanese. And Carthaginians. They were from Ethiopia. We have to understand something, even to those who hate the historic church. You have to understand that your salvation has only been given you through the historic church, no matter what you say of her. Because historically, there would be no scripture, there would be no gospel, there would be no doctrine. The heretics, had it not been for the bishops of the Orthodox Church, we would not know there is a Trinity. None of these things would have been defended. We would have gone in all directions at once, and we would be like sectarian America is today, each group contradicting the next. And it would have lasted about the same amount of time that it's lasted here in this country. America started out with a non-sectarian view of Christianity for a few minutes in the Bay State Colony, started fighting, and it splintered from there, like throwing something through glass. you know, slow motion, the baseball goes through the plate glass window. At first you just see this hole, and then suddenly, and the whole thing comes in. Well, it's taken about 400 years on North American continent, 200 years specifically. So you have to understand, first of all, let's get something straight. This business of pitting modern evangelistic zeal against Orthodoxy, as if somehow Protestantism has come up with evangelism and the Orthodox didn't do it, is nonsense. It's like a son coming to his father who read bedtime stories to him every night, who's now studying literature, and he says to his dad, "Yeah, you're not interested in reading, you know." "Well, excuse me, I taught you to read." Now, if you want to be more specific, let's just look at a few things. The biggest landmass on the globe is the Slavic landmass, Slavic and Asian. Look at your map. Everything else is water. America's little and sitting over here, and it makes for a great picture. That's why we were always so scared of the Soviet Union, because when you rolled it out on a map, it looked like they were over half, two-thirds of the Earth, because they are in terms of the landmass of the Earth. The largest missionary effort in the history of the world that makes the Pauline journeys, Hudson Taylor, American evangelicalism, you could roll them all together and it would be tiny by comparison, is the Orthodox evangelism of Asia and the entire Slavic landmass out of the Byzantine Church. What Cyril and Methodius started and what continued for 1,000 years of Christendom has taught more people to name the name of Christ than everything else together, both just numerically. Numbers don't count, but if you want to talk numbers, let's talk them. Then, when you get to nearer to the early church, the missionary zeal and those journeys were the founding of the church, began Byzantium, took the gospel out. Where did that gospel message get to? England. The Celts were in the Orthodox Church. It was the universal Christian church. You look at their ancient liturgies, and they're much closer to the Orthodox today than to Rome. They did not recognize the papacy as anything more than the Bishop of Rome. Lyon, Irenaeus of Lyon, last time I checked, that was in France. This is the Western church as well we're talking about. All right. Now, when you come closer to our own era, you have to understand something. Most Americans, like me, like you, have seen our Orthodoxy in the American context. And we say, well, what are the Orthodox doing? Look, all this zealous Protestant work. What are Orthodox doing? Well, let's look at something. Protestantism arrived here on these shores in the Bay State and in Virginia almost 400 years ago. Okay. The oldest Orthodox church in my part of Massachusetts, which is one of the oldest parts of the American colonies, our church, which happens to be one of the oldest, is 75 years old. There are people in our church who were little children when it was founded. All right. There are probably 4.5, maybe 5 million Orthodox in the United States. Okay, 4.5, 5 million people who have come here in waves of emigration, mostly in the 20th century, and whose most of their churches are an average of 45 to 50 years old. All right, now, that can scarcely be compared to the, quote, Protestant presence of 120 million people whose fathers were the first, grandfathers were the first to arrive here in the Bay State Colony. And so what you have to say is if people say, well, Orthodoxy is invisible, it may be because the local Orthodox community is dead and uncaring. It may be because they're in one of those many places in the U.S. where Orthodoxy has only just arrived or just arriving, or they've put all their effort into simply getting a priest and coming, as, say, this group here has, to begin and to start an Orthodox community. So it's not apples and apples, it's apples and oranges. But now when you look at the contemporary American situation, there is a great deal of reaching out. You have all kinds of missionary efforts coming out of the American Orthodox Church, both in this culture and around the world. And when you look at the third and fourth generation of Orthodox who were zealous, who are not just there because their grandparents were, you have a tremendous explosion of interest. You mentioned your Orthodox Bible. Well, first of all, there's no such thing as the Orthodox Bible. The New Testament itself is in Greek. The Greek church has been using it without a break now for close on to 2,000 years. It's not like there's a, quote, Orthodox Bible. They just simply mean that's a study Bible of the New Testament. There are Orthodox commentaries on the New Testament that would fill up, overwhelm, and sink any Protestant seminary library. The Orthodox have an incredible tradition of commentary. The only difference being is that Orthodoxy has newly come to the English-speaking shores of America. But in the last 10 years, 15, 20 years, especially the last 15, you have found evidence of a tremendous explosion of interest in Orthodoxy in this culture. How can you measure it? Well, a few years ago, there were plenty of Orthodox who remember the era when there were very few books in English on anything to do with Orthodoxy. If you look through the Light and Life catalog now, it runs to something like 8, 9, 10,000 titles if you put there St. Vladimir, everything else together. If you look 10,000 is too many. 4 or 5 thousand. If you look at something like the newspaper I edit, The Christian Activist, and you look at the fact that most of our readers are Orthodox, and that we started out with the first print run of 2,000 copies, and there's now 65,000 subscribers, those 65,000 people are not apparently disinterested, but are using these materials and other materials as fast as people can produce them. So I would just say Orthodoxy in the United States has to be seen for what it is. It's arrived recently. It's felt its way slowly along. It's gradually put its own church communities together. It's now consolidating and beginning to reach out to people. The missionary tradition of Orthodoxy is tremendously zealous. And when you talk about some monk saying, well, we're not interested in evangelism, we just wait for people to see our example, he should be right. Because in the Orthodox context, evangelism of just words, without worship, without accountability, and without community means nothing. So I would say I can't disagree with this statement at all, but for the evangelical mindset that wants a program, a TV station, a five-step this, four-step this, you know, Christ and weight loss, whatever, it's not going to be satisfied, because again, it's this question, well, what are you doing? Well, the door's open, it's Sunday, and we're worshiping God. And we've got evangelists who preach, and people are welcome to come into the church, and the Orthodox who are faithful and zealous will invite you to visit their church. And if the church doesn't speak for itself by its presence, what's it going to do? So I would simply say the kind of utilitarian approach, again, this thing is of what's it doing, as if somehow if we don't have a 10-point program and we're not claiming that we're going to reach the whole world for Jesus in the next 30 years or whatever, that it's not, quote, doing anything. I think it's doing a lot. And again, I would come back to the continuity of worship and the ability of the Orthodox to preserve that. You know, one of the most moving things I ever saw in my life, and I'll conclude here because we need to wrap up this session. And there's time, we're going to do more questions tonight for people who missed the opportunity. But one of the most moving things I ever saw in my life is I was going to go speak at a small Russian Orthodox church in New Jersey, in Paramus. And I misread my piece of paper or something, I forget what, and I arrived a couple hours earlier, and it was a priest doing a Vesper service at night, and I came into the building, and no one was there. The whole building was empty. And that's when I looked at my piece of paper, and I thought, oh, yeah, you know, I'm here at this time, and I'm supposed to be here at this time. So no one, the building was empty, and I came in very quietly. And there wasn't anybody there. There were just a couple candles up here lit. And suddenly I hear a voice. And there's the priest, quite an elderly gentleman. He's moving around the iconostasis. He comes out with the sensor. He's sensing the icons and doing the service. And I look around thinking, wait a minute, did I miss something? No one's here. What's he doing this for? You know, if you go into a Protestant church and you're there to speak, or the preacher's going to preach, and no one shows up, you know, is a Protestant preacher, preaching being the mainstay of Protestantism, is he going to stand there, sing the hymns alone, and preach his whole sermon to empty chairs? No, because you're putting on your worship service. I'm not saying every Protestant is, but the idea is it's something you do for them, for these guys. You're, quote, doing something. Well, this priest didn't know I was there, and I stood at the back for an hour. And he went through the whole Vespers, including walking down and sensing where everybody should have been standing, even though nobody's there. Okay, now again, it depends what world are you living in. In the spiritual world, he is doing something. He's praying for his congregation. He's worshiping God. He's joining in with the people in front of the throne of God who are also smelling the incense of heaven, if you want to put it that way. From the Protestant point of view, he'd be much better served to go preach on a street corner. Take your robe off, get out there and do something. You got to show me the bottom line. What's the result? The American, how many people did you sign up this week? What are they giving? Are we growing? Did you sell them a book? What's the deal here? But from the Orthodox point of view, evangelism was going on at that moment because the door of that church was unlocked. And anybody who wanted to walk in would have been seeing the Orthodox Vesper service of the historic church carried on without the priest missing a beat, doing it the way it has always been done, treading the path of the faithful. So I think before we bandy these terms around, like somebody does this, we do more things, we do that, we first have to define what do we mean when we say doing something. And I think that when you have a church that is so faithful to the worship of God, that it wants to be pleasing to God to the extent that if it's Vespers and the priest is alone, he's doing the Vesper service, in my book, he's doing something. And he is being a witness, and that's very much the church I want to be in. So that's the last question for this session, and we'll continue.